And so I made the two-stage model a part of my own theory in a 1985 book, but only a part, and I tried to go beyond it. And this is where it gets dicey. I'm even more convinced today through the work of Heisenberg, as well as others at this conference, and so on, that the two-stage model is an important part of any adequate theory of free will, and then indeed that it's also an important and crucial step in the evolution of human freedom, perhaps the first if it's all the way down in those early organisms that Martin talked about. The ability to randomize in lower organisms affords them flexibility and creativity as it does for humans. But I believe, as I did in the 70s, that a number of other steps are needed to get from this first crucial evolutionary step to full evolution of free will in human beings, and that the two-stage model must be folded into a larger picture. That's the idea. That picture is presented in my paper as follows. And here again, I have to summarize. One must note first that indeterminism doesn't have to be involved in all acts done of our own free wills, which we're ultimately responsible. Most everyday acts, it's not even involved. It's muted, it's damped. If that was so, human behavior would be a good deal more haphazard than it is. Not all acts of free will have to be undetermined, but only those by which we made ourselves into the kinds of persons we are, namely those self-forming actions I talked about. Now, I believe these undetermined self-forming actions occur at those difficult times in life when we're torn between competing visions of what we should do or become. Perhaps we're torn between doing the moral thing or acting from ambition, or between powerful present desires and long-term goals, or we're faced with difficult tasks for which we have aversion. I think these are very common. They happen every day, as a matter of fact. Just getting up in the morning, this morning, for example, after 4 hours of sleep is a good example. In all such cases, we're faced with competing motivations and have to make an effort to overcome temptation to do something else we also strongly want. There's tension and uncertainty in our minds about what to do at such times, I suggest, that opens a window to the influence of background indeterministic neural noise. And again, I don't say one quantum event. No, background noise, I think, is what we need indeed, just as Bob suggested, which is normally muted or damped when we act from settled motives and character. The uncertainty and inner tension we feel at such soul-searching moments of self-formation would then be reflected in the indeterminacy of our neural processes themselves. When we decide under such conditions, the outcome will not be determined because of the preceding indeterminacy. And yet it can be willed, and hence rational and voluntary, either way, owing to the fact that in such self-formation, the agent's prior wills are divided by conflicting motives. I give the example here of a businesswoman conflicted about helping an assault victim in an alley and going on to an important meeting. An inner struggle ensues between her conscience and her career ambitions. If either choice is made, it will be the result of an effort to overcome the strong temptation to make the other choice. When we, like the woman, decide in such circumstances, and the indeterminate efforts we're making become determinate choices, we would make one set of competing reasons or motives prevail over the others then and there by deciding. In such cases, as I show, indeterminism would function as an obstacle to success without precluding responsibility. I offer other examples to show this. For example, of trying to solve a mathematical problem with some indeterminacy in one's neural processing. Other examples of the assassin and the husband illustrate the same point. The assassin may miss the prime minister if he aims with a high-powered rifle from a distance, and the husband failed to break the table when he's arguing with his wife and gets really angry and swings his arm down upon it. He may not break the table as well, because there are perhaps some undetermined quantum events going on in his arm swing, making the momentum of his swing indeterminate and so on. And the assassin may be a little shaking and so on. So the assassin may miss and the husband fail to break the table because of some undetermined events. Yet if they succeed, they can be held responsible because they intentionally and voluntarily succeeded in doing what they were trying to do, even though it was undetermined what they did. It would be a poor excuse for the husband to say, poor excuse for the husband to say to his wife, I didn't do it, chance did it. Even though it was a matter of chance that it happened, literally a matter of chance that it happened, and it's a terrible excuse to say chance did it and I didn't. And that's a very important. What have I done here? I have enfolded the indeterminate. And this is my basic problem with the two-stage model. He's got free and then will. You got to enfold the two of them together into one thing. That's what I'm trying to do. And it took me a long time to figure out how to try to do that. But that's basically the idea. Now, where am I here? Okay, so he's poor excuse for his wife, and that's a little personal history action. okay. A further step has to be taken for a full account of free will, however, a step that was not available to the ancients and made free will seem to them very mysterious. And that's to appeal, in my view, to parallel processing in the brain. Imagine in cases of inner conflict, characteristic of self-forming actions, like the businesswoman's, that the indeterminism which is providing an obstacle to her overcoming temptation isn't coming from an external source, as in the other examples of the assassin and so on, but it's coming from her own will, since she also deeply desires to do the opposite. Imagine in such cases of self-formation, competing neural networks, each influencing the other and representing the agent's conflicting motivations. The input of one of these networks consisting in the woman's reasons for acting morally and stopping to help the victim, the input of the other, her ambitious motives for going on to her meeting. The indeterministic noise, which is an obstacle to her making one of the choices, would be coming from her desire to make the other and vice versa. The indeterminism thus arising from a tension-creating conflict in the will, which is characteristic of self-formation. In such circumstances, when either of these pathways reaches an activation threshold, which amounts to choice, it would be like solving a cognitive task through effort by overcoming the background noise produced by the other. I argue in the paper, and have shown at greater length in my 1996 book, that in such conditions, the choices, whichever one is made, would not be inadvertent or accidental or capricious or merely random, because they would be willed by the agents either way when they are made, and done for reasons either way, reasons the agents then and there endorse. I also argue at some length in the book that these conditions taken together rule out each of the reasons we have for saying that agents do not have control over their actions and are consequently not responsible for them. Reasons such as compulsion, coercion, constraint, inadvertence, accident, control by others, and so on. Okay. Does it make sense to talk about agents simultaneously engaging in multiple cognitive tasks in this manner? Well, much current scientific evidence points to the fact that the brain engages in such parallel processing in cognitive tasks like perception and recognition. If this takes place on the input side of the cognitive ledger, in perception and recognition, I suggest, it may take place on the output side as well, in practical reasoning and deliberation. Such a capacity, I believe, is essential to the exercise of free will. In cases of self-formation, agents are simultaneously trying to resolve plural and competing cognitive tasks. They are, as we say, of two minds. And you can feel this when you are debating a difficult issue. We say they are of two minds, yet they are not two separate persons. They are not dissociated from either task. The businesswoman who wants to go back to help the victim is the same ambitious woman who wants to go to her meeting. She's torn inside by different visions of who she is and what she wants to be, as we all are from time to time. But this is just the kind of complexity needed for genuine self-formation and free will. And when she succeeds in doing one of the things she's endeavoring to do, she will endorse that as her resolution of the conflict in her will, voluntarily and intentionally, not by accident or mistake. Note that these reflections give us the beginning of an answer to the further question asked earlier about how one might get from the randomly generated action that Heisenberg postulates in as characteristic of many living things to what philosophers have traditionally called the freedom of the will in more complex beings like us. Such randomly generated action in living things would provide an evolutionary template for the development of free will. But what one would have to add to it are other rational and reflective capacities to imagine different possible ways of acting. Bob mentioned some of these different ways of acting, and also different internal perspectives of visions of who one might be. That is, to imagine, as I put it earlier, creatures like ourselves who could be from time to time figuratively of two minds without being two separate persons. Being such creatures would require more than mere intelligent behavior and acting in pursuit of values. It would, in addition, require capacities for higher order evaluation and reflection, and the distinct possibility of different internal goals. In the latter part of the paper, I respond to a series of objections to this view, and I obviously can't go over them all. One of them is that if something happens merely as a matter of luck, it could not therefore be something in your control and some in your action. I try to answer that as best I can. It's been a standing objection to my view. And another objection is that we are not introspectively aware of performing multiple cognitive tasks in such choice situations. And I'm not claiming that we are. But what persons are introspectively conscious of when making self-forming actions is that they are trying to decide about which of several options to choose. And either choice is a difficult one because there are resistant motives pulling them in different directions that will have to be overcome whichever choice is made. In such introspective conditions, I'm theorizing that what's actually going on underneath is a kind of parallel processing in the brain that involves separate endeavorings to resolve competing cognitive tasks. The larger point here is that introspective evidence cannot give us the whole story about free will. If we stay on the surface, things are likely to appear obscure or mysterious. Something comes out, as free will has so often appeared down through the centuries. What's needed is a theory about what might be going on behind the scenes when we exercise free will, not merely a description of what we immediately experience. And in this regard, new scientific ideas can be a help. And finally, I relate it all to the medieval idea of liberum arbitrium voluntatis, because another objection here is that choices would not be our doing, but merely a matter of chance. And they would see, it would seem, be arbitrary. This is a very strong objection. It's been made by Al Mealy, among others, under the guise of the luck objection, namely that such choices would be arbitrary. Since agents can't, in principle, have sufficient or conclusive prior reasons for making one choice rather than the other. I argue that this is not a defect, but an essential feature of free will, and I'm almost done. The term arbitrary, as I note, comes from the Latin arbitrium, as in liberum arbitrium voluntatis, free judgment of the will, the medieval designation for free will from Augustine onward. In this connection, I ask one to imagine a writer in the middle of a novel. The novel's heroine faces a crisis, and the writer has not yet developed her character in sufficient detail to say exactly how she will act. The author of the novel makes a judgment about this that's not determined by the heroine's already formed past, which does not give unique direction. In this sense, the judgment, arbitrium, of how she will react is arbitrary, but not entirely so. It had input from the heroine's fictional past and in turn gave input to her projected future. In a similar way, agents who exercise free will are both authors and characters in their own stories all at once. By virtue of self-forming judgments of the will, arbitria voluntatis, SFAs as I call them, they are arbiters of their own lives, making themselves out of a past that, if they are truly free, does not limit their future pathways to one. Thanks.